enjoy the blessings of the Lord. A man who believes in Christ will enjoy the blessings of the Lord and be firm in faith. Can we open, and he will flee from every appearances of evil. Can we open to 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 19? And can somebody else go to Galatians 5 verse 1? And maybe another, 1 Thessalonians 5, 22. So we said that the characteristics of the righteous one is that the man cannot stand in the way of sinners. He cannot sit in the seat of the scornful. We said the first character is that he's the blessed of God. He will not associate with evil. He will be somebody who detests evil. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Are we there?
2 Timothy.
Thank you. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19.
Yeah. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription: the Lord knows those who are his, and everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
This verse is still reiterating and may flee from the appearances of evil. The Lord knows those who are serving him. We have to flee from every appearances of evil in the mighty name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Can somebody read Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, please, if you're there? Thank you. Or 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 22.
1 Thessalonians 5, 22 is abstain from all appearances.
Thank you. Again, it's still interesting the fact that we have to, as Christians, if we want to be known, if we want to enjoy the benefits of Christ, we have to abstain from every appearances of evil. Can somebody read Galatians chapter 5, verse 1?
It was for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourself be burdened again by a yoke of slavery.
First, if you look at that verse where he said it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. He has already set us free, but he's asking us, we still have the choice to either remain free or now be in bondage or slavery. So even though he's paid the price, he's asking us to abstain from every appearances of evil so that we can be completely free. However, we have the choice, so to either remain on that path, or if we continue to do this evil work, then we become slaves to our own actions. Praise the Lord. Amen. I pray the Lord will help us. Amen. In Jesus' name. He said, the man who sits in the seat of the scornful are those who mock the heaven or anything that represents God. The man who sits in the seat of the scornful is someone who mocks heaven or anything that represents God. So we are in terms of the seat of the scornful, we are talking about people who mock not particularly the religion, but who mock things of God, the heaven, things that God represents. You know, people who say, we still have believers who will say, I don't believe that Christ actually died. I don't believe that Christ did that. You know, basic fundamentals of the Bible. We still have people, you know, people who were brought up and brought up in the Bible, who are Bible scholars, who still question some basic things in the Bible. Everybody is entitled to their opinion, but we have to be very mindful so that we don't sit in the seat of the scornful. That is what the Bible is referring to. It said the scornful man is the man that mocks the heavens or things that represent God. So somebody was asking me, what is the difference between, the person was trying to say that this Christianity is just, it's just a phase. And how can you say God is one? God is the Father, God is the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You know, I don't bother to go into such debate because I don't want to err. I don't want to say anything. You know, and you can just see, and the person gives you all kinds of Bible verses. They actually, in some cases, they are not really willing to learn. It's not as if they don't know, they are trying to learn. No, they just want to mock or scorn. They just want somebody else to join them. And I haven't got the time for that. So we should be very careful. When you go to place of work or, you know, just group discussions and people are mocking heaven or mocking things that God represents, we should be very mindful either to walk away or be quiet. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Can we look at Exodus chapter 5, verse 2, please? those who openly defy the sacred place of God, those who openly, they open their mouth and they defile it. They say anything, you know. Things that are sacred to God, those who open their mouth and they defile it, we should be very, very careful not to engage in such conversations. Exodus chapter 5, verse 2.
And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
If we look at, can somebody go to Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 19? He said, a foolish man may think foolish thoughts. A foolish man may think foolish thoughts, but the scorners go to a set further and blunt it out proudly. He said, out of the abundance of the heart, the man speaks. Whatever comes out of my mouth, people say, oh, it just came out. I didn't really mean it. The Bible says, out of the abundance, whatever is in there, something just comes out. So don't say, I didn't mean it, you know. It's out of what is in there that something came out. And that's what the Bible is saying. And he said that you're a slave to your words, because the words are very powerful. Words are life. The words can either build somebody or kill somebody. So your words are very, very powerful. They can make and they can break. They can build and they can kill. So when you say, and so what the Bible is saying, he said the scorners, they go further and blunt out proudly. So we are saying that the scorners, they mock the word of God. They mock things that Christ represents. But what the Bible is saying, that the scorners, they even take it a step further. They don't actually think about it in their mind. They say it out openly. So which means they mock, openly mock Christ. So we should be very careful not to engage in such conversations. Praise the Lord. And they said, the scorners are not reachable because they refuse to listen. Therefore, the man that will be blessed does not relax himself with those who sit in the wickedness, who sit in the secure of their wickedness. So if you want to be blessed, you must not be seen in that environment of the scorners, because they are not reachable. What the Bible says, they are not reachable because they will refuse to listen. So it's not because they haven't heard the word. No. They have refused to listen and they are not reachable. So as a Christian, the blessedness of God, you must not associate yourself with such people or be in close cabal with them, which means very close needs or close relationship with these people, or support the advancement of the kingdom of darkness. Praise the Lord. What they said, the great lesson to learn from this whole verse is that sin is progressive. One evil propensity or act leads to another. So which means is that if you commit one sin, it leads to another. And that leads to another. And before you know it, it becomes a multitude of sin. So, and he said, he who acts by bad counsel may soon do evil deeds. So they say he who acts by bad counsel. So that person might not be a bad person, but he only just received the wrong counsel. So he will act on it. So it's not as if he received it, but he received it and he went for that and he acted on it. He said, may soon do evil. May soon, which means you still have a choice to hear it and walk away. He said, may soon do evil. And he who abandoned himself to evil doing may end his life in total apostasy from God. What does that mean? So what he is trying to say is that one sin leads to another. I read a book and somebody said, when you sin, something dies in you. He said, when you sin, when you commit a sin, something dies. And as you continue to commit sin, something will continue to die. It could be a cell, it could be a spiritual cell in the body, but the more sin you commit, something dies. And that then the person went for to explain that when you now receive Christ, when the Bible says, he said, the years of ignorance God overlooked. He said, so when you now accept Christ, and you now receive Christ. Christ, you know, he said, you are a new creature. All things are passed away. All things become new. You become alive again. So everything comes back to life. So God gives you a new slate to start. He said, but from then onward, then you become accountable for whatever you do. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So he said, to meditate on God's word is to discuss with one another concerning great things in it. with a close application of mind. So what this Bible is encouraging us to do, to try and have a close associate with like minds, people who will give you good counsel. You know people that are good. You know, if I ask somebody now to say, if you want good advice, do you really, if you really need advice, do you have anybody you can go to? I'm sure in our head, we all have one or two people that we know can give us good advice. And if you also need bad advice sometimes, you also have somebody that you can go to. I remember when we were in the boarding house then, when you are doing something, there are some group of girls you can go to. And you know the kind of advice that they will give you. And when you are doing something, when there are some other things, sometimes you have already thought about the thing, but you are not bold enough to actually do it. You just need somebody else to encourage you. And you go and meet them, and they just give you little encouragement that you are doing it. You say, oh, they were the one that convinced me. They didn't really convince you. You knew in your mind that's how it's going to end. And sometimes, some will also be going through some things. You just go and meet a sister, and you also know what that sister will say. And the sister will tell you one or two words, and you become stuck. You can't move forward, that thing will be your subconsciousness telling you, you cannot do this. So sometimes we shy away from these people. There are people, they could be people in authority. It could even be a colleague at work. It could just be I have a friend, she's not a Christian, she's not an unbeliever. Sometimes I find this very difficult to understand. She's not born again, but she's somebody that I would say she's an example of anything that you can say is, you know, I wouldn't say it's Christ, but she's this kind of person. She will come late, she's the first person that will come to work. In terms of work, she's excellent, anything. In terms of friendship, you know, somebody who does not talk about other people, she's there. So if you are looking for advice, she's somebody that I can just go to say, this thing, what do you really think? She say, if it's me, I won't do it like this, I'll just do it like this. And I'll just take what she says. So if you have people like that at work who are not even Christians, you can actually look at a place of work and say, that's somebody that I can really go to if I just need, you know, like, I'm just tired, this is what I got going to permission, what do you think? And she'll just say, do it like this and do it like this. And I'll actually do it like that. And you remember, those people are not born again, they're not even Christians. So what I'm trying to say is that we all know people that are role models, not really role models, that can give us good counsel. So we just have to identify them. Praise the Lord. And it says the result of fulfilling this condition, he said the source of his blessing, praise the Lord. Can somebody read Jeremiah chapter 17 verse 8? Jeremiah chapter 17. We said the condition of being the blessed. So we are looking at the condition for divine blessing now. That's what we are looking at.
Jeremiah 17:8.
Yeah.
They will be like a tree planted by the water.
Yeah.
That sends out its root by the stream. It does not fear what it comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fail to bear fruit.
Praise the Lord. So what God is saying, he said these are the conditions for being, for divine blessing and its result. So if we say we are blessed, he said the condition as stated, that man who is saying is the blessed of the Lord, he delights in the law of the God. That's the first thing. He delights in the law. So what are the law? Love your neighbor as yourself. Do this, do that. Those are the law. He said that man delights in it. It doesn't mean that he will not err, but he will err, but he will pick up himself again. He delights in the law of the Lord. The man desires affection. Every motive in his heart are moving principles to the soul by the side of God. He said he takes up the law of the Lord as the rule of his life. He meditates on the word of God day in and out. He said, this man, he bringeth forth fruit in due season. So what we are saying that if you are the condition for being blessed, we've looked at it, that the condition for being the blessed of the Lord is that you will not sit in the seat of discomfort. You will not, you will not be a scorner, which means you will not sit in the seat of discomfort. You will not walk in the council on the ungodly. And so we are not looking at, so if you don't do all these things, then what are you going, so what are the conditions for being blessed? And that's what he's saying now. He said that man would delight in the law of the Lord. He would meditate on the word of God daily. Then this is where the blessing actually starts. He said he will be like a river that is planted by the rivers of water, which means his source is never endless. He will just be like a river. He said he bringeth forth fruit in its seasons. He didn't say seasons. He said his leaf shall not wither. Mm. Why would the leaf not wither? There are seasons. There's winter, there's, you know, sometimes, you know, there's, you know, the leaf will dry. Mm. But he's even saying that the leaf will not wither because the source is all forever running. He said he's intentionally positioned. Mm. God intentionally positioned that person, regardless of their location or status. Mm. That person is positioned, cultivated by God to grow in the knowledge and service of God. So even in the midst of being in the UK, even if the person stumbles into the UK, maybe without status or anything, what this Bible is saying is that that person is located, is strategically placed in that place. He may not recognize it right now, but there are people that God has placed around him that are there to fulfill his own purpose. So even if he finds his way, all he needs to do is just to follow what the Bible is saying. And after some time, he will start to recognize the importance of A, B, C all around him, that they all have a role to play in his life. Praise the Lord. Amen. He said he will experience irreversible fruitfulness. Irreversible means not taking one step forward and taking five steps backward. He said no. He said he would experience irreversible fruitfulness, which means even if he's going and he steps on one, even if he doesn't move from a particular step for some time, he might remain there. But the Bible is saying he will not go back. So he will not take a step further and three steps backwards. No, he said it's not going to happen. So even if he stays on a particular step and he doesn't move to the next one, it's fine, because he's not just going to be moving. There will be times where he will, you know, things will be slow, but the Bible is saying that he will not reverse. He would experience irreversible fruitfulness and will not suffer any kind of loss. So he will not suffer. Somebody was telling me that, did you hear the figure of the coronavirus? I said, the Bible says, he said it has gone to 5,000. I said, the Bible says, he said 10,000 shall fall by the right hand side. He said 1,000 by the right hand side, 10,000 by the left hand side. I said, but it shall not come near our dwelling. Mm-hmm. We know that people are dying. Mm-hmm. I don't watch the news anymore. Not really because I don't want to be informed. It's just because of the figures, the statistics. It's very alarming. If you continue to, you know, I still hear, I still get some of the information I want to get, but I don't dwell on it. I don't dwell on, 5,000 died yesterday. No. He is assuring us that we shall not be victims. He is saying that we will not experience any kind of loss. So even if people are dying around you, you have to hold on to this word that I, Esther to Summer Erawi, I will not experience any form of loss, which means my children will not die during this COVID. Nobody related to me, my household, my immediate family, my extended family will not die during COVID. We shall not be victims in these situations in the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. He said, we shall, and if you look at it, the people that are dying, in fairness, we are not better than them. But it is just his promise. You have to hold on to that promises. So the people that are dying, we are not better than them. We are not even better placed than them. But it's just his faithfulness. And you just have to hang on to that word that he's saying that we shall not suffer any kind of loss. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
He said he will be healthy in all round. So God is also assuring us about our health. So apart from the fact that you shall, you know, you shall be planted by the rivers of water, you will not experience any form of loss. He's also, you will not experience any irreversible blood. He's also saying that you shall be healthy all round and prosperous and enjoy the fruit of your labor, which means concerning the children, concerning your children, concerning your work, effort. He said you shall enjoy the fruit of your labor. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And can somebody read 3 John chapter 2 for us to round up? Praise God. It says, for us to be blessed, we have to abstain from every appearances of evil and live by the word of God. We have to, for us to be blessed, for us to get these blessings, for us to be healthy. If you look at the blessings that he has said, he said, we'll be healthy all round. We'll be prosperous. We'll enjoy the fruits of our labor. We'll be planted by the rivers of waters. He said, we will not have any irreversible blessings and we will not suffer any kind of loss. For us to have all this, he said, we should abstain from every appearances of evil and live by the word of God. So, praise the Lord. Amen. Can somebody read 3 John chapter 2 before we go?
Chapter.
Yeah, it's just one.
One chapter. Okay, two.
Mm. 3 John chapter 2.
Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. He's still reassuring us about health, that we are going to enjoy health all around us. Praise the Lord. It doesn't mean that even if you're enjoying health, it doesn't mean that you might not have high blood pressure or you might not have diabetes. You might still have it and still manage it. Before I was born, my dad already had, you know, type 2 diabetes before I was born. And he lived all his life, and it wasn't the diabetes that he died of. So even though you still have it, some people say, oh, what are we talking about? Talking about health, but I already have it. It doesn't matter. You can still live well and still enjoy that health and still be able to manage it. Praise the Lord. Given everything that we have learned, I just want us to think about stories in the Bible. And I just want us to think about stories in the Bible. If we can give any example of people, you know, who the Bible called righteous in spite of righteousness. I gave an example with Joseph, who lived in Potiphar's house. You know, so if we can think about people in the Bible calls righteous, if you can think about anyone and look for any scripture to support it, or even if you don't even have the scripture, if you can just think about anybody in the Bible, if you can give us an example, we should all be able to give examples of people in the Bible who the Bible refers to as righteous because of their deeds or because of the way they worked. Praise the Lord. Job was one of them. Yeah. Mommy, can you share more light into that?
Yeah, Job. Satan went to God and said, why would Job not serve him? You have surrounded him with everything. You have done this, you have done that for him. Give me the chance. You will see that he will fail you. Because God trusted him, God allowed it.
Yeah.
Say, I trust God, my servant.
Yeah.
Say, but whatever you do, don't touch his soul. And we could see that even when his wife was mocking him, even when friends were mocking him, cause your God and die. He did not. He remained righteous. He remained focused. There were a lot of challenges coming his way that time, but he remained righteous. He did not look back. And his end was better than the beginning.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Job was a very good example, just like mommy said. And sometimes you wonder the way, regardless of everything that he went through, he still stood firm.
Mm.
And I think we have to also recognize that sometimes when we go through storms, when we are in the midst of a storm, the presence of a storm does not indicate the absence of God.
Mm-mm.
So even if we are going through storm, it doesn't mean that we are already there on our own. Praise the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Has any other person got any other one?
I want to say Enoch.
Sorry?
Enoch
is another one.
Yeah. It was normal.
Praise the Lord. That's another very good example as well. Do we have another one?
Daniel
was another one. And Meshach and Abednego. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Has anybody got any question? Anything? Okay, in the absence of that, Satyaji, can you pray for us, please?
Thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we bless you. Amen. Thank you for today. We appreciate you everything that you can do. We thank you for this Sunday that you make us come together as a church again. Father, we appreciate you. We bless you. So thank you for everything we've learned today. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, come and live in us in Jesus' name. Father, the Spirit not to sin against you, Father, come and give us in Jesus' name. As we go into this service, Father, go with us in Jesus' name. Father, we commit everything that we're going to do today in church today. Everyone that is going to minister to you, Father, we commit them into your hands.